It's been a while since I've been here. Just want to thank God for giving me the opportunity to preach here. And I pray that the Lord continues to be with us. Give me one moment while I load up. I left my my sermon printed out at home, but I do have it on my laptop. Thank God for that. Told me to grab both just in case something always happens. Satan is always busy, but we're going to thank God. Amen. Just want to pray before we continue. Our Father in heaven, Lord, we thank you once again for bringing us here. As we continue to serve you, Lord, we pray that you give us knowledge, wisdom, and understanding as we search your word. Convert our hearts and our minds. Make us better servants, better stewards for you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Let's turn our Bibles to Luke 13, and we're going to start 1 through 5. Today's sermon is, How Will You Respond? Turn your Bible to Luke 13, 1 through 5. I'm going to read in your hearing if you can't see there. There were present at this season some that told him of the Galileans, whose blood Pilate has mingled with their sacrifices. And Jesus answering said unto them, Suppose ye that these Galileans were sinners, above all Galileans, because they suffer such things? I tell you nay, but except ye repent, ye shall likewise all perish. Are those 18 upon whom the Tower of Siloam fell and slew them, think ye that they were sinners above all men that dwelt in Jerusalem? I tell you nay, but except ye repent, ye shall likewise perish. Today's subject is repentance. Now, the Bible speaks of two types of repentance. Based on 2 Corinthians 7:10, it says, For godly sorrow worketh repentance to salvation, not to be repented of, but the sorrow of the world worketh death. So there's two types. There's one that is godly sorrow, seeing salvation from our Lord and Savior. And there's a sorrow of selfishness, worrying about yourself with total disregard to the injury of the Lord. Now I'm going to give you three examples of godly sorrow. The first comes from Psalm 32, 5 through 7. Psalms 32, 5 through 7. This is David speaking. He says, I acknowledge my sin unto thee, and my iniquity have I not hid. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord, and thou forgavest the iniquity of my sin. Selah. For this shall every one that is a godly pray unto thee in a time when thou mayest be found. Surely in the floods of great waters they shall not come nigh unto him. Thou art my hiding place. Thou shalt preserve me from trouble. Thou shalt compass about me with songs of deliverance, Selah. Now, in this acknowledgement of God, he's acknowledging his sin. He's not trying to hide. He's not trying to make up for any sin he's committed in the past. He's come to God confessing, hey, I have sinned. I cannot hide from you, Lord. Please forgive me. This is a deeply godly sorrowful repentance. Patriarchs and Prophets says, David's repentance was sincere and deep. There was no effort to palliate his crime, no desire to escape the judgments threatened, inspired by his prayer. But he saw the enormity of his transgression against God. He saw the defilement of his soul. He loathed his sin. It was not for pardon only that he prayed, but for purity of heart. David did not, in despair, give other the struggle. In the promises of God to repent sinners, he saw the evidence of his pardon and acceptance. next example is the prodigal son. Turn with me to Luke 15, 18 through 21. Luke 15, 18 through 21. And it says, I will arise and go to my father, and will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. And he arose and came to his father. But when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion, and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. As we see again, he first acknowledged that he sinned against heaven first, then his father. The next example, I'm sorry. My screen keeps going off. Our next example is Jonah 3. Jonah 3, 5 through 10. Jonah 3, 5 through 10. I'm going to start at 4. And Jonah began to enter into the city, a day's journey. And he cried and said, Yet 40 days, and Nineveh shall be overthrown. So the people of Nineveh believed God and proclaimed a fast and put on sackcloth from the greatest of them, even to the least of them. But word came unto the king of Nineveh, and he arose from his throne, and he laid his robe from him and covered him with sackcloth, and sat in ashes. And he caused it to be proclaimed and published through Nineveh by the decree of the king and his nobles, saying, Let neither man nor beast, herd nor flock, taste anything. Let them not feed nor drink, but let man and beast be covered with sackcloth and cry mightily unto God. Yea, let them turn every one of his evil way and from the violence that is in their hands. And he can tell if God will turn and repent. And turn away from his fierce anger, that we perish not. And God saw their works. They turned from the evil way, and God repented of the evil. And he said that he would not do unto them, and he did not. Now, Nineveh, as you know, was an enemy of Jerusalem. Of God, he was an enemy of God's people. Jerusalem wasn't established yet. Not only was he their enemy, they worshiped all other gods. They were very evil. They were very cruel the way they dealt with people. So not only did they take God's word, they only served God. Because if they would have took, okay, this is another God we can serve, or this is another God we can obey, God wouldn't have forgiven that way. They would have taken it lightheartedly, but they put all their gods aside. They asked for forgiveness, put on sackcloth, and they asked God for forgiveness, totally from the heart, and God saw their hearts and he forgave them. Now, I'm going to read a quote from Patriarchs and Kings about this. It said, their doom was averted. The God of Israel was exalted and honored throughout the heathen world, and his law was revered. Now, not too many years later, was Nineveh a fall of prey to the surrounding nations throughout forgetfulness of God and through boastful pride. So God saw them, he was under by them, and he saw their hearts. An entire nation was saved. Now, the next type of repentance is a sorrow of selfishness. And I want you to turn with me to Matthew 27, 1 through 5. Matthew 27, 1 through 5. I'm sorry, yeah, 27, 1 through 5. And it reads, When the morning was come, all the chief priests and the elders of the people took counsel against Jesus to put him to death. And when they had bound him, they led him away and delivered him to Pontius Pilate, the governor. Then Judas, which had betrayed him, when he saw that he was condemned, repented himself and brought again the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and elders, saying, I have sinned in that I have betrayed the innocent blood. And they said, what is it that to us? See that thou to that. And he cast down the pieces of silver in the temple and departed and went and hanged himself. Now, in this instance, you see the fact where it said that he repented himself. Not that he sinned against God. And you have to remember this, Judas was the one that he wanted everything to go his way. If you read in Desire of Ages, if you read the section about Judas, it's very interesting. Judas was the one that he was the man of stature that everybody, all the disciples looked up to. But he still had something in his heart. He wanted everything to go his own way. You know, he loved Jesus. He believed what he was saying. But you have to remember, when I preached last time, when I talked about how the Jews overthrew the Greeks and how they had self-reliance in themselves, Judas wanted the same thing to happen to the Romans. And so he wanted another physical king. Jesus was teaching, repent, repent. But he himself was like, no, we want a physical king. We want to take our kingdom back. This is what you need to do. And he knew Jesus' heart. He knew how Jesus loved people, how he healed people, and he wasn't about physical altercation. So what Judas did was when he saw, what inspired Judas was when he saw Jesus feed the 5,000 with the loaves of bread, the five loaves of bread and the five barley loaves and the five fishes. And when he saw that, that was his inspiration. He was like, okay, this is what we need. He was the one that inspired the people to take Jesus as king. Remember, Jesus had to retreat over the Sea of Galilee because the people wanted to take him as king then. So Judas was like, okay, he can do it. This is what we need. The people are inspired. And so when Jesus went into the temple and they asked him about the coin with Caesar's image on it, and what did he say? Render unto Caesar's which is Caesar's, but render unto God's which is God's. That threw Judas off. He said, no, you're not going to plan. This is because Judas was also a greedy person. He wanted to be second under Jesus. That was his motivation. So when that happened, Judas was like, no, we gotta change this up. So that's when he decided, I'm going to make Jesus overthrow the Pharisees and the Romans. So he didn't dispute Jesus openly, but in his heart he disputed Jesus. So he went to the Pharisees and he said, I will turn Jesus into you. And he thought that was going to force Jesus' hand, but Jesus, it didn't force his hand. So when he saw it, he repented to himself, not to God, because he thought, man, I did the wrong thing. I planned this wrong. It didn't go right. And so that was another example of ungodly sorrow for repentance. That was very selfish of Judas. All right, the next one is Saul. And I'll go to turn with me to 1 Samuel 15. And we'll start at 15 through 18. First Samuel 15, we'll start at verse 14. No, let's start at 13. And Samuel came to Saul, and Saul said unto him, blessed be thou of the Lord. I have performed the commandment of the Lord. And Samuel said, what meaneth then this bleating of sheep in mine ears and the lowing of oxen which I hear? And Saul said, they have brought them from the Amalekites, for the people spared the best of the sheep and of the oxen. Thank you. Thank you, brother. The best of the oxen to sacrifice unto the Lord thy God, and the rest we have utterly destroyed. Then Samuel said unto Saul, stay, and I will tell thee what the Lord hath said to me this night. And he said unto him, stay on. I'm going to continue reading. And Samuel said, when thou wast little in thy own sight, was thou not made the head of the tribes of Israel? And the Lord anointed thee king of Israel? And the Lord sent thee on a journey and said, go and utterly destroy the sinners the Amalekites and fight against them until they be consumed? Wherefore then didst thou not obey the voice of the Lord, but didst fly upon soil, and didst evil in the sight of the Lord? And Saul said unto Samuel, Yea, I have obeyed the voice of the Lord, and have gone the way which the Lord sent me, and have brought Agag, the king of Amalekite, and have utterly destroyed the Amalekites. But the people took of the spoil sheep and oxen, the chief of the things which should have been utterly destroyed, to sacrifice unto the Lord thy God in Gilgal. And Samuel said, Hath the Lord his great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices, as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to hearken than the fat of the rams. Now, this is another example. Samuel was selfish. He, not only did he not repent, he blamed it on the other people. See, Samuel was kind of in bad standing with God, and he knew it. And so, no, not Samuel, Saul. So what Samuel did was he prayed for him, and God gave him another chance to redeem himself. But Saul, not only did he disobey, he wasn't sorrowful about it, and he blamed the people. All right, and the next one is Genesis. We're going to talk about Cain. Genesis 4, 13 through 14. Genesis 4, 13 through 14. And it reads, And Cain said unto the Lord, My punishment is greater than I can bear. Behold, thou hast driven me out of this day from the face of the earth, and from thy face shall I be hid. And thou shalt be a fugitive and a vagabond in the earth. And it shall come to pass that every one that findeth me shall slay me. Now this was after Cain had slayed Abel. The Lord came to him. His sacrifice was not acceptable. And when the Lord came to him, not only was he not sorrowful to God, this is the first murder. This is the first murder that man has ever seen. You know, they say when men first murder their first person, I guess when they murder somebody the first time, they go in shock. You know what I'm saying? They go in hiding, they hear voices, you know, they can't sleep at night, they're unrestful. And this is the first murder of Cain. And he wasn't sorrowful at all. He was worried about himself. The people are gonna kill me. Please protect me. You know, like, he wasn't sorrowful about to God. He wasn't sorrowful about killing his brother. This was the first thing. He was so selfish that he didn't even care. The first time seeing murder on this earth. And our next example is Esau. Turn with me to Hebrews 12, 16 through 17. Well, 16 and 17. All right. Hebrews 12:16 through 17. All right. It says, I want to start, yeah. Least there be any fornicator or profane person as Esau, who for one morsel of meat sold his birthright. For ye know that afterward, when he would have inherited the blessing, he was rejected, for he found no place in repentance. Though he sought it carefully with tears. So this explains how Esau, because of appetite, sold his birthright. And he wasn't mad that he disobeyed God or went against God. He was mad because, hey, I want my birthright back. You know, I want my inheritance. I want my money. God, you know, I'm not sorrowful. He didn't repent because he was sorry to God for his sin of appetite. He was just, hey, I just want my inheritance back. And Patriarch the Prophet says this. It says, his grief did not spring from conviction of sin. He did not desire to be reconciled to God. He sorrowed because of the results of his sin, but not for the sin itself. So these are three examples of sorrowful selfishness. Sorrowful selfishness. All right. Now, I'm going to read this because this topic is about repentance. It says, God repentance, not like man's repentance. The strength of Israel will not lie nor repent, for he is not a man that he should repent. Man's repentance implies a change of mind. God repentance implies a change of circumstances and relations. Man may change his relation to God by complying with the conditions upon which he may be brought into the divine favor, or he may, by his own action, place himself outside the favoring condition. But the Lord is the same yesterday and today and forever. Hebrews 13, 8. So, in the case of verse 6, the question brought to God was, are they worse than others? But Jesus' issue was repentance. The issue is not what happens to you. The issue is, have you repented? Now I'm going to go to finish this off in verse Luke 13, 6 through 9. This is the next part. It says, he spake also the parable, this parable. A certain man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard, and he came and sought fruit thereon and found none. Then said unto he the dresser of his vineyard, behold, these 3 years I come seeking fruit on this fig tree and find none. Cut it down. Why cumbereth it the ground? And he answering said unto him, Lord, let it alone this year also, till I shall dig about it and dung it. And if it bear fruit, well, and if not, then after that thou shalt cut it down. Now, I want you to put yourself in the place of the vineyard owner. He wanted to cut it down because the function was to bear fruit, and there was no fruit. After 3 years of investing time, fertilizing, moving it around, putting it in the right place, maybe covering it from frost, all this investment he put into this plant for 3 years, and there was no fruit. The issue is, have you repented? But the thing about it is, when you read this, when you continue to read it, the vineyard dresser said, and he answering unto him, Lord, let it alone this year also, that I should dig about it and dung it. I hear grace in that. Let it alone this year also. And now I have some questions for you. This is about repentance. I just want you to think to yourself, you don't have to say it out loud. How much time have you been given on this earth to repent? How many times can you count where you knew Jesus gave you another time, another chance? Was it when you were in an accident, when you went off on somebody, maybe you cut somebody off in line, maybe you kept driving to somebody's house, you were in the wrong place at the wrong time, maybe you cheated on a test? How many times you knew Jesus gave you another chance? You slack. Maybe in school you were slacking on the paper. And the teacher came. I remember one time I'm not going to lie, I slacked on this paper. It was a 300-page. It was a program, and they had to write 300 pages. And I was with a team before, and, you know, we had to split it up, and I had to do, like, 80 pages. And I was like, man, I did 70. And, like, it was a program. It was SQL. And at one point, I just kind of, like, blacked out, and I was just, like, typing myself, like, man, I hope this is right. I hope this is right. Like, I only got 10 more pages left. And I don't know if you do programming or SQL, if you know anything about that, but it can be cumbersome and repetitive, and then it kind of, like, you just fade out. And I'm not a programmer. I'm a networking guy. I'm not a programmer whatsoever. And I remember going to class, and the teacher came in, and he said, you know what? Everybody gets an A on their report. And we all, I think, and it wasn't just me. Everybody in the class was like, whoo. And he was like, you know what? I'm going to grade on the curve today on the test. And everybody was like, because not only did we have to do 300 pages together, we had to study for a final. And it was, when I tell you, I was so scared. I was like, man, I got to take this class over. I'm trying to graduate. And I got a relief. I got a B plus out of that class. And I was so happy about that. Because the final is 30%. So basically, you know, if you miss, you've done it, then you're done. But the vineyard narrative is mentioned in the Bible a few times. And the focus of we are the vineyard and God is the keeper implies a great deal of investment and expectation. Has anybody ever planted a tree in here? Planted flowers? Amen. I remember my friend bought some property and he wanted to plant some lemon trees, fig trees, and apple trees. And in North Carolina, you know, the further south you go, that sandy clay is kind of hard. You never know what you might hit a huge rock. And we were out there for like 3 hours and 87 degree heat. And I said I was going to do it. I like to commit to my word. And it was hard, you know, because we were trying to do the Ellen White method. So you got to go 3 by 3, so 3 feet deep, 3 feet wide. And it was tough work, you know. And we were happy when the brother came the last hour and had the, I forgot what they call that tool. It's automatic. It like basically digs in the ground for you. Oh man, I can't think of it right now. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
You know? Yeah, it turns the soil. Yeah, we were so happy because that the last two trees, we were just looking at them like, man, we gotta. It's turning 95 degrees out here. But you know, I helped some friends, and you know, it wasn't on my property, but I was like, hey, you know, how is that tree going? You know, is it producing fruit? Oh, you guys know him, Andre, brother Andre. You know, we put a blue fig tree, two apple trees, and I think an orange tree. And, you know, I always ask them every time I see them, how are those trees going? How are those blueberry bushes going? And I know my wife and kids, they planted some tomato trees and tomato plants and what was it, the bell pepper. And the bell pepper wasn't producing fruit. And my wife was getting angry at it. Like, it's flowering, but it's not, you know. And sweet potatoes, yeah, sweet potatoes. Amen. So, you know, God is investing in us time and effort, and he expects us to produce fruit as well. So when God created you, he had great expectations for you. The moment that he thought of you, he planned for you to be in heaven with him. Revelation 3:21 says, "To him that overcometh will I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame, and am set down with my Father in his throne." That's a great promise.
Amen.
And you know what's interesting about that? The promise that he's given us is what Satan wanted. That's why he wanted to overthrow Jesus. He wanted to walk among the fire, you know, and with the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. He wanted to take Jesus' place. But what he can't do, God is going to give us the opportunity to do. So when God comes seeking for fruit, there's nothing more frustrating, disappointing, discouraging, and heartbreaking to God to come seeking fruit and to find none. Now, Pindu, I know about this church. I've seen you, I know the programs you have. I've seen you passing out tracts. I know the speakers that come here. I know you have some powerful speakers. And God is expecting fruit within this church. To whom much is given, much is required. And God does not waste his time. And every time he redeems someone from a situation that we have no business being in, every time he's bailed us out of our own foolishness, God is not doing that because he's soft. God is not doing that because it's soft. He's doing it because he's looking for somebody to produce fruit. How many times has God repeated over your life, "Let him alone"? 1 Peter 5:8 says, "Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion walketh about, seeking who he may devour." The devil analyzes everyone in here. Everyone in here. He walks about your life. And he wants you. Every time you sin, you can't get over that sin. He wants you. And he asks God for your life. No, he can't get over that one particular sin. He's not going to make it. Let him burn with me. If I'm going to burn, he's got to burn too. That's what he's doing. He's walking around and he's seeking, hey, want him. I want him. And he's saying, but God is replying, let him alone. Let him alone. When we made a mistake in our lives, let him alone. When we studied for homework or on the Sabbath, if I took a class on the Sabbath, God was like, let him alone. If somebody got pregnant, somebody was pregnant out of wedlock, God said, let him alone, let her alone. Somebody working on the Sabbath, let them alone. Somebody with attitude problems, always getting into fights, scuffles, let them alone. The vineyard concept appears more than once in the Bible. Over in Matthew 20, 16, I'm going to paraphrase this. It's 21 through 16. So the householder goes out in the morning. He hires some workers in the field. And he comes back around noon, he hires a second shift. And then he goes around the evening, he hires another group. And an hour before all the work is done, he hires one more group. Now, as everybody's getting their pay, the first group notices something. They notice that everybody is getting the same pay. And they're upset. Hey, I worked 8 hours. This guy only worked one. Why are we getting the same pay? See, basically, to break down this parable, God is saying that when it comes to the vineyard, everybody gets the same paycheck. If you join the church today, if you're a fifth generation Adventist, or you joined 75 years ago, everybody gets the same pay. And what is that? That pay is eternal life. When the final day comes and repentance is exercised itself over your life, the payoff is forever with Jesus. You know, that's why we have to be careful about separating ourselves or putting too much pressure on people when they first come to church, or, you know, not letting people, you know, do certain things. If there's a new member in the church and he wants to join the ministry or start a ministry, hey, let them join. Let them join the ministry. You know, be watchful, but let them join, hey. And, you know, certain churches have issues with this and that, and, you know, the order of service are, you know, we had an issue where, shouldn't have said that, but I know a church had an issue with, you know, fellowship. You know, some people welcome and say, hey, stand. They don't have to stand. You sit down. Don't hug. Just shake your hand. You know, it's just little things like that that can separate churches, and we shouldn't have that. And Matthew 20 simply teaches that all of us get the same pay. But in Isaiah 5, God's devotion in the vineyard, his work, his effort is explained. I'm going to read 1 through 7. It says Isaiah 5, 1 through 2, but I'm going to read 1 through 7. Isaiah 5, 1 through 7. And it reads, now I will sing to my beloved, a song of my beloved touching his vineyard. My beloved, half a vineyard in a well-fruitful hill. And he fenced it and gathered out the stones thereof and planted it with the choicest vine and built a tower in the midst of it and also made a wine press therein. And he looked that it should bring forth grapes, and it brought forth wild grapes. Now, O inhabitants of Jerusalem and men of Judah, judge, I pray you, betwixt me and my vineyard. What could have been done more to my vineyard that I have not done in it? Wherefore, when I looked that it should bring forth grapes, brought it forth wild grapes? And now I will tell you what I will do to my vineyard. I will take away the heads thereof, and it shall be eaten up, and break down the wall thereof, and it shall be trodden down. And I will lay it waste, and it shall not be pruned nor digged, but there shall come up briars and thorns. I will also command the clouds that they rain no more rain upon it. For the vineyard of the Lord is of hosts is the house of Israel, and the men of Judah his pleasant plant. And he looked for judgment, but behold, oppression, for righteousness, but behold a cry. So it's an interesting thing right here. He planted choicest grapes, but they produce wild grapes. And Signs of the Time says, Christ described his vineyard fenced about the commandments of God. So the law is written the way it's written because it's in our nature to react against the law of God. Thou shalt not have any gods before me, make engraven images, take my name in vain, remember the Sabbath, honor your parents, don't kill, don't commit adultery, don't steal, don't lie, don't covet. It's written that way because it's in our nature to react against God. And we know God's nature is perfect because the Ten Commandments are his character. Now, in ancient Israel, let me take some water real quick. In ancient Israel, the keeper would come and check the walls to make sure they were still in place. Sometimes guys have to check our walls to make sure they're intact. Deuteronomy 30:19. Oh, wait. Oh, yeah, that's right. 31:19, sorry. Says, I call heaven and earth to record this day against you, that I have set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore, choose life, that both thou and thy seed may live. The same way God presented the tree of life and the tree of knowledge of good and evil to Adam and Eve, he presented the law to us. But the death he's talking about is not the first death, it's the second death. But why are we so fascinated with death? The R-rated movies now is PG movies. You know, you can't tell what is what now. You put a movie on TV and you say, what do they say at a PG movie, a PG-13 movie? But we're fascinated with the movies, the lying, the alcohol, the drugs, tobacco, the pride, the adultery, gossip, stealing, certain types of music, and putting things before God. See, we don't know death is bad for us, so God must fence us in with life, so he can put a fence around us. Then he says he's going to gather up the stones. Now, let's go more into the gathering up of the stones. You know this parable of the sower and the seed, right? Matthew 13:5-6. Some fell upon stony places where they had not much earth, and forthwith they sprung up because they had no deepness of earth. And when the sun was up, they were scorched, and because they had no root, they withered away. Christ's object lesson says this, and I'll read it in your hearing. The seed upon stony ground finds little depth of soil. The plant springs up quickly, but the root cannot penetrate the rock to find nutrient to sustain its growth, and it soon perishes. Many who make a profession of religion are stony ground hearers. Like the rock underlaying the layer of earth, the selfishness of the natural heart underlies the soil of the good desires and aspirations. The love of self is not subdued. They have not seen the exceeding sinfulness of sin, and the heart has been humbled under a sense of guilt. This class may be easily convinced and appear to be bright converts, but they only have a superficial religion. So the spirit of prophecy says you couldn't see the stones because they were beneath the soil. And not until the seed tried to take root, it ran into the stones. Now, some of us might have stones beneath the surface. We look good on the outside, but we can't fool God. And even though when God digs in to pull out those stones, it's going to be a painful process. But Jesus is going to gather up the stones, and by the time he's taking them out, there'll be a great big gap, but the Holy Spirit can fill that gap. Then the Bible says he plans it with the choicest vine. What's the choicest vines? That's the tracts we have, the sermons, our Bible, Sabbath school, amazing fact studies, prayer meetings, books, AY, church events, the outdoor The outdoor events you guys have, you guys are well planted in this church. And then he talks about building a tower. See, in ancient Palestine, in the vineyard, they had these towers. They put them in the middle of the tower, and they hired boys to stay in those towers. The tower represents the temple. And the job of the boy was to cry aloud if he saw foxes or someone trying to steal from the vines. He was to cry out. The cry out represents the Holy Spirit. What is the cry? Isaiah 30, 21. And thine ears shall hear a word behind thee, saying, this is the way, walk ye in it. And turn, when ye turn to the right hand, and when ye turn to the left. How many times have we heard that voice? How many times have God told us not to laugh at the offensive jokes at work? How many times have he told the students not to peer somebody else's test, knowing that they might have the answers wrong too, and you take it over? How many times have he told us adults not to abuse our office supplies or our work accounts? Some people ship stuff all the time in and out of work using the FedEx and UPS accounts. How many times he told you not to do that? How many times he told you not to watch that movie because you knew it was bad, but you went back and watched it the second, third, fourth, and fifth time? How many times did he tell you not to read those romantic comedies or those romantic novels? Or visit that web page? Or the young people say slide in DMs? How many times did you hear that voice right before you did it? And now the boy in the tower is shouting, don't take it, don't read it, don't use it, don't post it, don't watch it. Do not pollute your brain. You see, because at some point, that voice gets quiet. I want to say this. God's love is forever. His grace is not. We don't believe in once saved, always saved. God's love is forever. His grace is not. Turn with me to Genesis 6, 3. And it reads, and the Lord said, my spirit shall not always thrive with man, for that he also is flesh, yet his days shall be 120 years. So, turn with me to Psalm 69:28. Psalm 69, verse 28. Pages keep getting. I'm going to read 27 and 28. I'll read 28. It says, let them be blotted out of the book of the living and not be written with the righteous. Now, our books are already in the book of life. It's up to us that they're blotted out. You know, we don't have to earn our way into heaven. God wants to see everyone in here in heaven. But it's up to us if we decide, we make the final choice if we make it to heaven or not. God wants everyone there. Satan doesn't. And Revelation 22:11. And it reads, he that is unjust, let him be unjust still. And he which is filthy, let him be filthy still. And he that is righteous, let him be righteous still. And he that is holy, let him be holy still. At some point, we all have to make a decision. It's either going to be my way or God's way. There's no other way around it. My mom can't get me to heaven. My wife can't get me to heaven. My grandmother can't get me to heaven. Only me. My relationship with God, that's what gets me into heaven. The only thing. And there's a quote I'm going to read for you. It says, this is in Letters and Manuscripts. It says, by the law is the knowledge of sin. But the law cannot pardon this transgressor. Repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ would write pardon against their names in the books of heaven. And next we're going to talk about the wine press. The wine press is for what? Stamping out, purifying, getting all the juice out of the grapes, the good stuff. And God puts trials and tribulations in our lives because they're necessary. Why are they necessary? Because we have to go through some things. God has to bring us to a point where we're not self-reliant on ourselves, the pride of life, envy. He puts us through some things where we go totally to the brink where we have to decide we're going to do it his way or our way. And his way is best for us. And he does this because he wants us to see that only through him we can be saved. And that's it. Point blank range. That's it. God wants you to be peculiar. He wants you to be holy. And he wants you to represent him in this godless world. So, as we get back to Luke, what happens next? What's happened next in this parable? Let's read. It says, and he answering said unto him, Lord, let it alone this year also, till I shall dig about it and dung it, and it bear fruit. And if not, after that I shall cut it down. See, here's the thing. The dresser has been doing the same thing for 3 years, but nothing has happened. For 3 years, Jesus was in his ministry. He did the same thing. He preached, he healed, he made disciples. But every year, he didn't see a change in result. And he was focusing on the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the scribes. He wanted them to see the importance of his mission, but he didn't see anything. The problem is not the method. The problem with the fruit is the response. Because all the other vines in the vineyard were bearing fruit. It was just that one vine. See, the word of God works if we read it. Prayer works if we pray. Church works if you go. Ministries works if you participate. Tracts work if you pass them out. This is the method. Nothing has changed. It works. I'm going to close with this. Historical sketches. But before I talk about this, I want to talk about what happens next. There's a show Me and the Family watch. But the kids love it. Kanan loves it. It's called Relative Race. You know, these editors, they do a good job. You know, the race is about finding loved ones that you've never known. Most people have been adopted. They never met their parents. They never knew they had brothers. They never met their mother. And they go through this race. And in the race, you know, they have a lot of time because they have to travel by car and they have to go to this place and they have to do like a quick, easy challenge and then the time stops when they get there. And, you know, the show is so good at editing, you know, you don't want to root against anyone, but you want everybody to win because you want somebody to, hey, they never met their father, their mother, their sister, no, they have a brother. I'm not going to lie, I had a tear, I jerked a tear one time, you know. It was, it's an intense, it's a good Christian family show. But when you stop, you don't want anybody to lose because it's like, man, what happened? And so did they get to their location and a lot of time, did they complete their mission? And it stops. And, you know, when they get to their location, it shows them when they get to their location, they stop. And you think in order, hey, they were here, or they're not going to make it, they got lost. Oh, man, you know, they got directions wrong. And then they announce who got there first. And sometimes you're surprised, like, oh, man, that's what happened. But before you get there, you got commercials. You know, they try to sell you, you know, toupees, and, you know, they try to, you know, they advertise certain things like, you know, toys for kids and whatnot. And you're sitting there, you're waiting, what happens? And in this verse right here, we're trying to see what happens. What happens next? And this quote says, it says, the dresser of the vineyard will put forth yet one more effort to save the fruitless tree. The Son of God will come in person to plead with the chosen people. He will take upon himself humanity and set before them the example of his own life. If this fails to bring them to repentance, it is their last trial. After that, thou shalt cut it down. In the terrible destruction which came upon the Jewish nation, we read the fate of the unfruitful tree. Under the symbol of the fig tree, Christ represents not the Jews only, but all who have neglected to improve the gifts of heaven. He has bestowed upon us greater blessings that we were granted to his ancient people, and he claims of us fruit corresponding to the gifts bestowed. What is this fruit? It is a pure and holy character, godliness, self-denial of others, good, meekness, and lowliness of the heart. Jesus claims repentance, faith, and obedience. He came to leave for a man a perfect model of character. He was obedient to all the requirements of his Father. If we follow him, we shall in our life carry out the precepts of God's holy law. So, how will you respond? Will you repent? Is there something in your life that you can't get rid of? Will you seek God, or will you blame him for every time you do it? Will you be selfish and blame others? You know, it's our response. You know, our response is so important to God, and he's investing time in us. He's in his church. I've seen you guys. We have the Bible. We have the word. We have the message. I haven't been in any church that can quite deliver the word like an Adventist church. I've seen some close, but then they kind of stray off here and there. You know, it's okay. It's two Sabbaths here. Or, you know, you don't have to pay tithe here and all this. You know, like. But I never seen anybody that had this word, that had this knowledge. We have the spirit of prophecy. You know, yeah. Not too many churches have that. No other church has that. Yeah. How will you respond? Is there somebody here, before I close today, is somebody here in this church that would like to dedicate themselves to God? If so, I please you to talk to my elder right here, my elder back here. See them. If you want to start taking Bible studies, see these brothers right here. So, you know, when Jesus comes back the second time, he's seeking fruit. Will you bear fruit? That's what I want to know. That's what he wants to know. Will you bear fruit? Amen.